We've done a few tier lists here on the channel, and now it's time to apply that concept to Disgaea. I mean, that series is part of the Holy Trinity of this channel, so it has to be done. The format will be the same as the other videos. There is a tier chart, there's games that go on that chart. Where they go depends on my opinion on them. We'll cover both mainline games and spin-offs, and if you haven't watched the Neptunia and Senran Kagura videos, check out the playlist at the top right, or take a look at the description. I feel like I haven't really talked that much about Disgaea in a while, so some of you might not really know what that is even, you know, what that even is. So here's a quick rundown. Disgaea is a strategy RPG. It's turn-based and gameplay takes place on a grid. So it's like the anime version of chess, which I think is still the best way to describe it. It's quite over the top in terms of gameplay. It's not just the outrageous looking attacks, but there's hardcore game mechanics going on too. You can level up your characters all the way up to 999, but in order to get the most out of them, you have to reincarnate them, which brings them back down to level 1, but with higher base stats. And you can continue that cycle several times for maximum madness. Not to mention, there's the item world, which are randomly generated maps inside items. There's tons of different classes too, it just keeps going and going. There's a lot of grinding in these games, but a lot of the game's functions are in fact optional. So if you don't want to go nuts in post-game, you don't have to. The storylines follow various groups of people in the Netherworld, hell basically. It's a different group every game for the most part. The plot of the games feels lighthearted because of the humor, but there's still a good amount of serious and even emotionally engaging aspects throughout. We'll go through mainline games first. There are 6 main titles overall despite what the numbering sequence may suggest. Disgaea D2, which is a sequel to the first game, came out between Disgaea 4 and 5, and is the reason for the numbering being slightly out of whack. In case you are wondering about all the enhanced versions or remakes, I'm going to consider them all together as one game for the purposes of this video. I don't think it makes sense to rank every individual version of the game. Let's start at the start with the first Disgaea game. Despite being the oldest game in the series, the game hasn't aged that badly, all things considered. The story is great, and many fans of the series feel that Laharl, Flan, and Etna are still the best cast. I kinda agree, so I'll give Disgaea 1 an S grade. Plus, I think this game does the best job in terms of world building and giving the player a good overall image of what the Disgaea universe is like. It's not like there aren't, you know, gameplay complaints, but I feel what I just mentioned transcends what I'm going to mention now. Something I find quite frustrating is the item world. Compared to most later games, it's possible to get stuck at certain floors. Imagine this scenario. You ran out of emergency exits, you're not able to kill all the enemies because they're on floating islands, and you're not able to access the exit portal because the island it's on is too far away. That's happened to me a few times, and reloading and losing progress gets old quick. Thankfully, that problem was fixed in later games. The throwing mechanics are also something that annoy me. They're much more flexible in later games, so it's a bit annoying going back to the old system. I do like the graphical improvements that have been made with Disgaea 1 Plus, so you get the HD sprites and all that, but it's a bit disappointing that certain gameplay elements haven't been refreshed or updated, like I mentioned. Still, I do think Disgaea 1 deserves its S rank, and in my opinion, it's where people should start if they want to get into the series. The second game, Disgaea 2, isn't a game that I think of as fondly as the first one. I'll give it a C rating. It's not that the gameplay got worse or something like that. In fact, it got better as things like game balance and level design, among many other things, became more polished and refined. I just wasn't a fan of the story. I didn't really find the main characters that interesting. With a game that has that much dialogue, it's, you know, kind of important for me in terms of overall enjoyment of the game. Disgaea 3 is a game that I think not enough people appreciate. I give it an A rating. I first got into the series back when this was the newest Disgaea game. At the time, it was the first game to be on the PS3. Unfortunately, that wasn't immediately evident in the graphics. The sprites still looked, you know, basically the same as they always did, and despite the higher resolution of the PS3, the environments didn't improve that much. So overall, it still kind of looked like a PS2 game, and that was a bit disappointing. Which reminds me, there was a review of the original Disgaea, which stated that it looked a bit like a PS1 game, so I guess history repeated itself there. But I still think there's a lot of good things to be found in Disgaea 3. I really enjoyed the story and the characters. The reverse school setting was really fun, I like how the good students were the ones that skipped classes and didn't do any work, while the delinquents are the ones that do the work and follow the rules. I do think Mao is quite annoying at times, but the highlight for me was how Almaz develops through the story. I also thought the story was a lot funnier than in most games. Often there was a lot of humorous back and forths between various characters. Well, every Disgaea game has that, to be honest, but I thought there was something particularly witty about the writing overall. With the gameplay, I quite liked the introduction of geocubes. I actually don't have a preference when it comes to geocubes versus geosymbols, but I did like that I had to rethink that aspect of the game. It was a nice change. Speaking of change, Magia Change was new for Disgaea 3 as well. In fact, a lot of functions and little touches now found in modern Disgaea games stem from the third game. Let's talk about Disgaea 4. This is the first Disgaea game I pre-ordered and got the limited edition of. I think this is a solid entry to the series, and I give it a B rating. One of the big deals with that game was the HD sprites and the improved environmental visuals. It was the best looking game of the series so far, and in my opinion, it's what Disgaea 3 should have looked like in the first place. Disgaea 4 also introduced more mechanics, including some base building that influences certain aspects of gameplay, as well as the ability to build your own pirate ships. I thought the story was alright. It had that uprising and rebellion theme. There was lots of references to the 2008 United States presidential election, which I thought was a cool idea. Back then, that was considered the craziest election yet, so it made sense for Disgaea to parody it and go a bit next level on the subject. While at the time I enjoyed Disgaea 4 more than Disgaea 3, I remember Disgaea 3 more fondly these days, mainly because of the story. Hence the fourth game getting a B rating. Here's where the previously consistent naming convention gets a bit messed up. It's the fifth game of the series, Disgaea D2. The title makes things doubly confusing because in the past, I've seen fans refer to various games as D1, D2, D3, and so on. D2 is a direct sequel to the first game. So the gang of Laharl, Etna, and Flan finally returns. And not as cameos this time. I enjoyed this game immensely, so I gave it an S rating. It combines my favorite cast with a lot of nice quality of life improvements not found in the first game. Character interactions are a lot of fun, and things like music and even the art style of the menus is very reminiscent of the original. It seems that not many people share my opinion on Disgaea 2. Metacritic scores aren't always the best thing to go by, but if proof were needed, we just need to look at the fact that it's the only mainline title in the series not to have an enhanced port. Or any re-release for that matter. It's a PS3 game only. So it probably didn't sell enough for there to be a re-release, which is unfortunate. The newest game in the series, Disgaea 5, gets an A rank for me. This is the first game in the series that is also on the Nintendo Switch. That makes it the first Disgaea on a Nintendo system since Disgaea DS. Because of that, it introduced a whole bunch of new people to the series. With Disgaea 5, there's several new gameplay additions. A few of them make life easier. For example, you can reposition characters during your turn without having to undo their move all the time. The thing is, the old way is so part of my muscle memory that I actively have to think about this feature. But there's a lot of little stuff like that that makes Disgaea 5 great to play. By the way, I heard that some older games that got re-released did get some of those improvements too, but for the most part, I only really have experience with the original releases. So if you have more to add to the topic, let me know in the comments. In terms of the story, I don't mind Disgaea 5. I thought it was good. If Disgaea 1, D2, and Disgaea 3 were my favorite in terms of story, and Disgaea 2 was my least favorite, then it would be somewhere in the middle hanging out with Disgaea 4. It's kind of interesting how certain elements of Disgaea 5's plot feel like they've been taken from other games. First of all, Killia and Seraphina look a lot like Valvatores and Vulcanus. Seraphina also has similarities with Rosalind from Disgaea 2, as both are daughters of overlords and both use guns as well. So that's the mainline games dealt with. I noticed that for me, the story is usually what caused me to give out the ratings I did. For the most part, the basics are the same across the board, with refinements and occasional sidesteps being the main differences. As always, depending on my mood, the scores and ranks will probably shift over time. Even when writing this script, I had to look up Disgaea 4 cutscenes on YouTube because I couldn't remember whether to pronounce Vulcanus as Vulcanus or Vulcanus. And then I started getting into the story as I was watching and started reconsidering how I felt about the story. It's just one of those things. Besides, the exact ranking isn't all that important anyway. The main point is just that we're having fun talking about Disgaea games. While the mainline games were quite consistent in their ratings, the spin-offs are a bit more varied, which makes sense because some of them aren't even in the, you know, JRPG or strategy RPG genre, I mean. There's three spin-offs, at least that's how many we got in the West. Prinny, Can I Really Be the Hero? Prinny 2, Dawn of Operation Panties Dude, and Disgaea Infinite. First, it's Prinny, Can I Really Be the Hero? Now we're really switching genres here. This one gets a C for me. I'll explain why, because there's actually aspects of the game that I really enjoy. It's a platform hack and slash game. You play as a Prinny, or as Prinnies, rather. The story is that Etna believes that someone stole her dessert, so she tells the Prinnies to get her some sort of ultimate dessert for her, or else. You have 1,000 lives. As a Prinny dies, it gets replaced by another one. The presentation and art style looks really good. Keep in mind this is a PSP game. Yes, this is emulated footage that you're seeing here, but still. The thing that lets it down the most is the platforming. To me, the controls feel a bit stiff and therefore difficult to get right. The game got a sequel called Prinny 2 Dawn of Operation Panties Dude. Now, that's a title. It plays, feels, and looks the same as the predecessor, which is why I decided to give it a lower score of D. The reason is that there really should be at least some sort of improvements. The plot is the same but slightly different in this game. Just replace Etna's dessert with Etna's panties, and there you go, you've got yourselves a sequel. Next up is Disgaea Infinite. I'm going to give this one a B. This is a visual novel that takes place between Disgaea 1 and 2 and follows Laharl, Etna, and Flan, as well as some other characters from the first game. Like the other two games, you play as a Prinny. Your task is to investigate a failed assassination attempt on Laharl. While doing so, he finds a magic clock, which has a very original and creative name, TikTok. It can talk, and it's Neptune. Just listen to this.
Just don't mind me if I start narrating and stuff all the time.
Neptune, TikTok, allows the Prinny to turn back time and possess other characters in order to investigate and solve the mystery. It's really interesting because you can see the conversations from different viewpoints, and you can get different endings depending on what dialogue choices you make. At this point, I want to mention that there are other games like Phantom Brave that people consider Disgaea spin-offs. In fact, I made a video about Disgaea spin-offs, and I even mentioned Makai Kingdom in it, but I guess it would be more accurate to consider those games as affiliated or related games rather than spin-offs. I only have limited experience with one of them, Makai Kingdom, so that's one reason not to include those in this video today. You, of course, can, so let me know what your rankings are, if you've played Phantom Brave, Makai Kingdom, you know, and all of those other ones. But yeah, that covers all the Disgaea games. Thank you to everyone who supports the channel. Check out Patreon if you want to help out. There's several benefits available, like being able to watch videos before they come out. Check the description for the links to all the things. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you again in the next video.